Welcome to Take Good Care,
an endeavor of Peachtree City Obstetrics and Gynecology. Our aim and mission is to serve as a source of vital information and discussion for women of all ages,
races,
and walks in life.
I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I am Dr. Cameron Green.
Welcome to our show.
We hope that you all checked out our last episode where we gave some brief discussion about maternity health care and the maternity morbidity crisis here in this country. And recently, there was a documentary that was presented on Hulu entitled Aftershock that has gotten a lot of critical acclaim as well as continued some much needed discussion in this area of health care disparity and maternal mortality, especially as it relates to Black and brown women. So we wanted to continue the discussion, and we'll be utilizing that documentary and some of the information that was presented as a means of just discussion. Again, we want to continue to have open forum and communication and shine a light on those issues that we feel are important to us as physicians, but also to our community at large. And when we were talking about this episode and thinking about the documentary and the information that was presented, I shared with my partners, it reminded me of when my mother had her first stroke. My mother's deceased now, but she had a stroke, massive stroke, 25 plus years ago initially. And when she had her stroke, what really impacted me was the way that my mother was written off from the beginning. So as soon as she was admitted to the hospital or evaluated in the emergency room and then admitted at the hospital and it was determined that she had had this significant stroke, she was unable to speak, couldn't really move much. And so the healthcare team was just making a decision that we just need to find a nursing home, send her to. Now, I was a physician practicing medicine at this time, and there was no consideration for anything else. And I realized that all they saw was an overweight, middle-aged Black woman. They had no concern for the fact that she was a mother, a wife. She herself had been a registered nurse for over 30 years of her working career, that she was a friend, a sister, a daughter in her own right, and had many children that were extended, adopted children, as we do in our village. You just, everybody's child is your child. So even though she only gave birth to one, that would be me, she was a mother to many. But that didn't matter. There was never a consideration that anything else could be afforded to her in terms of her recovery. So I didn't argue. I wasn't trying to change any minds because it was clear to me that all the minds at that particular hospital had already been made up as it related to my mother. So I went about the task of trying to get her out of that hospital and somewhere else where I could hopefully have a conversation with the healthcare team to let them know that, no, my mother was going home. And she was going to go home as fully functional as possible, or at least be given that opportunity. So thankfully, I was able to get her transferred to another hospital. And just because of circumstances, ended up contacting a cardiology colleague of mine at 9 o'clock at night because it was time for the transfer and we had to have an attending. And I asked this physician to please, if he could just act as the admitting physician for my mom tonight so I could get her transferred to this hospital. Tomorrow, I'll figure everything else out and get her tapped into the resources and things she needed for stroke recovery. This was an African American physician. Who brought his full team of residents and medical students to the rehab facility at 10 o'clock at night to fully assess my mother medically. And from that day until the day that she passed, some 20 years later, he afforded my mother the best care and compassion and gave us 20 plus years with my mother, who went home. It took 4 months in the rehab facility for her to get all of the resources that she needed for her rehabilitation that this cardiologist made sure happened, because he saw the humanity in my mother. He is my cardiologist to this day. And anyone who needs cardiology, I refer them to this physician. That has informed my care of all women, but in particular, women who are seen as marginalized and less than because of bias and healthcare disparity. So I wanted to share that as we move into this discussion of a very challenging and at times difficult to watch documentary that was recently streamed on Hulu entitled Aftershock. So Dr. Green, can you get us started just giving us your impression of the documentary overall and just anything that you wanted to share after viewing that powerful story and collection of stories?
So Dr. Williams, I had to watch it twice. We were discussing earlier that once you read what it's about, and it talks about maternal mortality, specifically African-American maternal mortality, you know what's going to happen. Didn't even have to know who the people were. You just know. You just know, which is sad and a whole nother story in and of itself. So I knew what to expect. So I had to kind of brace myself to say, okay, I have some time. Let's go ahead and watch it. So the first time I watched it as a physician. Which in watching it as a physician, it allowed me to kind of look at it from an obstetrician, you know, giving care. And so as I went through the movie, I thought to myself, you know, how did this happen? You know, why did this happen? And there's several points in the movie that it was kind of hard to separate the fact of being a physician and being a patient. Because I, you know, I have two children. And my first child was born when I was 35. And 35, for whatever reason, is considered advanced maternal age. I was a elderly gravida.
Oh, my.
And an elderly gravida is supposed to have other complications during their pregnancy because of the fact they were old. And I was old. Family history of high blood pressure. And so going into a pregnancy knowing that I'm a little older than most, I have a family history of high blood pressure, things could happen. And so when I'm watching the movie, I'm thinking, you know, trying to be that physician, being objective and watching as to why, I'm thinking, that could easily have been me. There's one line where the mom says, when they brought her to this hospital, I knew this was not the place she should be. And one of the reasons she said that was because they kept asking her the same questions. Does she use any drugs? Does she use any drugs? And she says, I told you that. She doesn't use any drugs. Because the daughter's brought in with a pulmonary embolism. And everyone's asking all these other questions, and not really listening or taking care of her. And she subsequently expires. Mm. And the reason it's called aftershock is the shock to the families that this affects. Mm. You know, you lose a pregnant mom, you know, after giving birth, and then the people that are affected are the people that don't have them in their lives, that don't have the 20 years mm-hmm. that Dr. Williams' mom was afforded. Mm-hmm. Because they're anticipating, she said, I was anticipating, you know, growing old with my child, mm-hmm. having conversations with my child, and now my child is gone and I have a grandson that has no mother. Mm-hmm. You know, here the husband is, he's never lived in the home by himself because his wife was always there. And so when a mother dies in childbirth, it affects not only the family, it affects so many people. It's so many people that are involved. And so when a person comes in, seeing that whole person and seeing who they are is important. Mm-hmm. And so the second time I watched it, you know, I watched it as a patient. And it affected me probably a little more as a patient, mainly because of the fact that, as I said, I was older. And, you know, I kind of worried about my pregnancy. And I did. And I tried not to. I was like, I'm not going to doctor myself. I'm just going to, you know, be the patient, you know, and listen to my doctors and do what they tell me to do and try not to make decisions on my own. So, of course, first pregnancy, I had spotting in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Then I had extra fluid, you know, and so extra fluid could mean something bad. So I had all the different tests to rule out all those bad things, and it ended up being idiopathic. So there's a lot of
idiopathic meaning.
Meaning there's a lot of reasons for it, but this is nothing serious. It's probably just happened. Mm-hmm. So just happened didn't really sit right with me. But because of that, I got lots of ultrasounds. Ultrasounds to look at the baby, ultrasounds to look at my son, make sure his anatomy was okay. And so I had to kind of call myself off the ledge of all the possible things that they might find each time I had an ultrasound. Mm-hmm. But instead, I have lovely pictures to go in the baby book. You know, and I had a wonderful, you know, delivery. Second child, no problems, wonderful delivery. And I can honestly say that although I watched aftershock and thought that could be me, I realized why it probably wouldn't have been me. Because I'm a physician, you know, and I kind of know what's going on. I went to a hospital where my colleague and I trained together. She's a physician. And so they knew coming in that this is a physician. But I thought after watching the movie the second time, suppose I went into labor and I had to go to a hospital that wasn't my hospital. Mm-hmm. I didn't deliver at the hospital I worked at because I just didn't want to, not because I didn't think well of it. I wanted to just deliver somewhere else. But suppose I went into labor in the middle of the night and I didn't make it to my hospital of choice. I had to stop and go to any hospital. Mm-hmm. How would they see me? Mm-hmm. You know, they would see me as a pregnant lady, a pregnant unmarried lady, because I don't wear my ring because I'm afraid I'm going to lose it at work. Mm-hmm. And my puffy hands in pregnancy, the ring certainly wasn't going to go on it. Mm-hmm. So they would see me as an unmarried, pregnant black girl. Mm-hmm. I am sure of that. And it is distressing that I knew that within my bones, mm-hmm. that that's exactly how they would see me, mm-hmm. if I were to go somewhere else. And that should not be the case.
No.
That should never be the case, that we should not be seen. So the movie itself talks about those particular situations where, you know, the moms are lost, but it also talks about what can be done. And I think for me, that was a hopeful part of watching it, that, you know, there are ways to let patients be seen. There are ways we can fix this, but you have to want to do it. Mm-hmm. You have to want to give them that space to go to a place, understand that these people are going to take care of me, and I'm going to have a good outcome. There's a story at the end of the movie that the couple realizes where they live has one of the worst maternal mortalities in the country. And so that particular hospital wasn't, in their mind, a good hospital. So they were looking at, you know, other options. And so their other option was, you know, a birthing center. Now, me personally, I don't think I want a birthing center because I want all the anesthesia you can give me. But I think that people should have the option. And I also think that option should be more affordable and safe, mm-hmm. so that you can make that decision not based just on finances. Mm-hmm. Because they were lucky that they were able to afford that particular option. But for a lot of people, that's not a choice for them mm-hmm. because this birthing center was safe. They did all the right things. They had all the right tools. They knew when to, you know, change paths if something was going to go wrong. And they allowed the patient to be involved in their delivery. And mm-hmm. so when that baby came out and I'm watching it on TV, I was just as excited as if I had delivered the baby mm-hmm. because she had an option. She had a safe delivery mm-hmm. and she was happy and she felt good about her labor and delivery mm-hmm. because she knew they really cared about her. And mm-hmm. that's all as an obstetrician you mm-hmm. ever want.
Exactly.
And that's all as a patient you ever want. And mm-hmm. so, you know, by the end of the movie, although it started off kind of rough, mm-hmm. the beginning, every time, the two times I saw it, you know, I felt good. I definitely felt good.
Talk a little bit more about why you said it was rough.
It was rough because the signs were there. When the lady had a problem in pregnancy, she said she didn't feel good. She said something was wrong. And nobody listened, you know? Mm-hmm. And not only did they not listen, they did the appropriate blood work to show that her platelets were dropping. And they still didn't do anything. And by the time they realized that it was, you know, time to deliver the baby emergently, and the dad says it, if they had intervened earlier, my partner wouldn't have died. And that's true, because if your platelets are 44 and low normal is 150,
right,
you're not going to clot real well no matter what you do. No, and they had to do a C-section. Mm-hmm. And he was told that, you know, her blood was like water, because it was. And so he has a healthy baby, but he lost his wife. Mm-hmm. And so that part was rough, because looking at the laboratory results and then looking at the response from the hospital, that their only thing to say was, this hospital has a mortality rate of, and they gave a number. I don't even remember what the number was, because the number didn't mean anything.
Doesn't matter. Mm-hmm.
It's like, okay, so you gave me the data, you mm-hmm. gave me the statistics, but what about the fact that I have no wife? What mm-hmm. about the fact that my mother-in-law has no daughter? What about her friends? What about all these people who are missing her? That was rough,
yeah.
You know, because that could have been prevented. The other lady, she went home. And she kept saying, I'm not breathing right, you know, I'm not feeling good. And she would call and they say, oh, you know, it's just pregnancy, you know, that, you know, something that happens in pregnancy, sometimes you just don't feel like you can breathe. And she kept saying it until the ambulance had to take her. They bring her in, the family's gathered, and all they're told is she's gone. You know, that was rough mm-hmm. because I remember one night I'm breastfeeding, and I look down at my feet and they're so swollen. So another talking off the ledge moment. Hmm. I have preeclampsia. I have postpartum. No, I don't. My blood pressure is fine. I don't have a problem. Mm-hmm. But if it was a problem, I know that I could have called my physician and she would have addressed it. She would have helped me talk myself off the ledge. Mm-hmm. Or she would have had me come in. She wouldn't have blown me off.
Right, because it deserved evaluation.
It did. It deserved evaluation. And that lady did not, Shimani did not get it evaluated. That's the character in Aftershock. Mm-hmm. And she's a real person. That's no longer here. And these are young ladies, mm-hmm. young, vibrant ladies that had their entire life ahead of them. And Aftershock demonstrates two examples, but they're not the only ones. Mm-hmm. And so that part was rough. Mm-hmm. That part was rough.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Guthrie, what are your impressions?
So this documentary, we could get 15 topics from this documentary.
And we may.
Yeah, we may. It just highlighted a lot of things for me. Like you, Dr. Williams, I had a situation with my father having a stroke. My father had a stroke when he was 83, which you're thinking, okay, older person, not unexpected. But what happened was my mom called me to tell me that my dad had passed out, and I flew from my house. It took me like 10 minutes to get there, and I got there right when the ambulance was getting there, and they were upstairs getting ready to take my dad away. But they weren't asking any questions. They weren't trying to evaluate him. They just walked in and saw an elderly man, thinking, oh, this is just the old people dwindling type thing. And so if I wasn't there, what they didn't realize was that this 83-year-old man had worked a 12-hour day, which he normally did at his place of business.
That he owned.
He was fully functioning. And, you know, and so when they walked in and saw this person who wasn't talking, I walked in and knew immediately what it was. And I kept trying to tell them, and they kept looking at me like, yeah, you know. And I was like, no, you don't. Finally, I had to stop him and said, He worked a 12-hour day at his business today. This is not normal for him. So like you said, it's just the preconceptions that come in when they see a person that can affect medical care. So that's number one, which of course flows into this film. I only watched it once. That was enough. I watched it once. And I was trying to toggle between being a patient, and I never had a baby, but just being a patient, thinking, what would I do in that situation? Mm-hmm. And then seeing all that could have been done mm-hmm. as a physician. So mm-hmm. it wasn't so much that. It was just, I was like, oh. Every time they said something else, I was like, oh, no. Yeah. I was like, are you kidding me? Right. You know, and it could have been something as simple as, like I said, even if the first time the first time she called with a complaint, okay, I could even see trying to reassure the patient, drink some more water, lay down, do whatever. But mm-hmm. if somebody's called you 3 and 4 times mm-hmm. with the same complaint, mm-hmm. just take a look. Just
it doesn't hurt anything.
It doesn't just hurt evaluating. Anything. That was hard for me to watch as mm-hmm. a physician. Mm-hmm. I was kind of hopeful at the end too, but it also brought up other issues for me that, like I said, you know, how do we work with, how as obstetricians, it even got into the history of how we got to, you know, how we became obstetricians, gynecologists.
Mm-hmm. Tell a little bit about
yeah,
that.
So, you know, which was, you know, and I hadn't thought about it that way. Mm-hmm. So in ancient times, women having babies, that's nothing new. That's been happening from the dawn of time. That's why we are here today. But all throughout history, it's been women taking care of women having babies, mm-hmm. right? So there was always the one woman in the village mm-hmm. or wherever she was that when somebody was having a baby would take care of the woman. Mm-hmm. Then it got a name. It was called a midwife. Mm-hmm. Still all through ancient times. Well, what started happening was they all of a sudden there was a man who wanted to take care of women, so they called it a male midwife, they said. Then men did not, they were saying it's understandable that a man would not have the empathy. He couldn't. He's never going to have a baby mm-hmm. As far as taking care of women. Also, the tradition of women having babies, it was always the men were over here, the women were over here. So all the things that went on in a delivery that were kind of secret and unknown, and not that they had to be a secret, but that things men didn't have to worry about with the women having a baby, now men were seeing that. And in a man's mind of, how do I fix this? You know, you're going to scream when you're in labor. Get over it. Mm-hmm. It's going to hurt. But in a man's mind, it's like, how can we make it better, right? So if we hook her up and if we do this. So then they started educating men in doing this. And then it became obstetrician gynecologist. And then what was so surprising to me was that they were even talking about in slavery times, mm-hmm. it was the black midwives mm-hmm. who were taking care of the white women having babies. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, when they started to see that this could be an enterprise, all of a sudden, white women were becoming midwives, mm-hmm. and they started to outlaw black women mm-hmm. being midwives.
Yes.
And then everything was moved to the hospital. Mm-hmm. And so that was just, that just caught me by surprise as to, but when you think about it, it makes perfect sense. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. again, here is something that was totally natural, taken care of by women, that has now become a very, and I'm a physician, don't mm-hmm. get me wrong, mm-hmm. I appreciate science and advancements, but just the whole history of how it changed mm-hmm. was very surprising mm-hmm. to me. Mm-hmm. What else? I was also the whole question of doulas and working with doulas as an OBGYN, recognizing that there's some issues there, but, you know, it should be a collaborative thing. It should not be adversarial. Dr. Green mentioned that in one place there was a birth center, but even in the place where in New York, where the other two main characters were having babies, they were looking to build mm-hmm. a birth center in the Bronx. And so it's just, again, it's going to take collaboration. Mm-hmm. It's going to take, you know, putting our minds to, you know, what's the goal? Mm-hmm. Keep in mind, what is the goal? The goal is not mm-hmm. that I get to do what I want. It's mm-hmm. for a healthy baby, a healthy family, mm-hmm. Everybody going home.
Everybody going home.
You know. Mm-hmm. So those are some of the things that kind of got me. They even got into the history of Sims, this famous obstetrician who's supposed to be the father of gynecology, and how he experimented on women. I mean, mm-hmm. there was just so much in this mm-hmm. in this documentary.
It's a lot to unpack. Yeah. Definitely a lot to unpack. And I think, again, as you said, this is not something that can be handled in one brief podcast episode, but something that we need to continue discussing and evaluating solutions. And, you know, one of the things that you guys have highlighted is that sometimes our interventions, no matter how well-meaning, you know, all the good intentions, don't get to the desired goal. Mm. You know, the intervention may have been a good intervention, but did it get to the desired goal, which is everybody going home healthy? And, you know, that's one thing I would say to patients, you know, as we were taking care of them in labor, you know, I say the goal is everybody goes home. We may do plan A. It may be plan B. Sometimes there's even a plan C. But we do what we have to do so that everybody goes home healthy. And for me, I think, you know, the only thing I really want to highlight or add from what the other ladies have mentioned about this documentary is, again, looking at it from a physician's eyes and saying, gosh, if they had just acted. And again, I understand in the hustle and bustle of modern medicine, especially in the obstetric unit, it can get very busy and it can be a lot happening. But we never should lose sight of the fact, as you said, Dr. Guthrie, if someone has continued to say that something is wrong or have a concern, even if 9 times out of 10, it's probably nothing, it's that 10th time when it is. And I never wanted it to be said that I didn't look. It may have been a little aggravating at 2:30 in the morning to have to get up and do that evaluation, but that's my job. That's why we're here, is to do the tough stuff and to make decisions and to help advocate for our patients and collaborate. Midwife, doula, you know, all of us have the same goal. And so we should all, nursing, respiratory therapists, anesthesiologists, we should all be working together to come up with the desired outcome of a healthy mother and a healthy baby and a family that gets to go home and enjoy years of enjoyment with that child or children. So it was disturbing and unnerving. And again, when we stopped practicing obstetrics, I think that was one of the things that was of concern, because we knew how much we took care of patients. All the high-risk patients. You know, the ones that nobody else wanted to take care of because of whatever. We all felt that they deserved good obstetric care. Didn't matter their background, didn't matter their ability to pay or not. Even those moms who showed up with no prenatal care, as many of them did. They still deserved the same treatment and level of attention to their concerns as issues as anyone else. So if nothing else, I hope that documentaries such as Hulu, the research that is going on, Hulu's Aftershock, the research that is going on, health equity, trying to be more inclusive with research populations as well as with healthcare teams, all of it should never lose sight of the humanity of the individual. These are people. They are daughters, their wives, their sisters, their mothers, and their families should not have to go through aftershock.
Right. And this brings up the term that was used in Aftershock was reproductive justice.
Yes.
And that's the big topic of the day with the recent Supreme Court rulings. Mm-hmm. But I looked up the definition of reproductive justice, mm-hmm. and it says the human right to maintain personal bodily autonomy, have children, not have children, and parent children we have in a safe and sustainable community. And going back to what you were saying, Dr. Green, that the reason why you knew that you had a better outcome possibly was because you were a physician and you knew the questions to ask and things to look for. But even in that documentary, Shimoni's mother worked in the mm-hmm. field.
Yep.
And she was saying to herself, here it is, I'm looking at these situations. I never thought it would happen to us, but
right.
there it was, you know.
Right.
So it's just being vigilant, mm-hmm. Again, being your own advocate, mm-hmm. and then hoping that we get to a place of reproductive justice mm-hmm. in this country for everyone, mm-hmm. all no matter who you are.
Right, mm-hmm. right. There's I think there was a doctor in the movie was talking about, you know, how you can change it. And the one thing he said that kind of stuck out in my mind the second time I watched it, affirming a person's dignity and making them seen is the way that you make them safe. It's not a luxury.
Say that again.
Affirming a person's dignity and making them seen is the way that you make them safe. It's not a luxury. And I think that's what we all talk about,
mm-hmm.
that we want to make people feel seen. Mm-hmm. And that's why we took all comers when we delivered babies, mm-hmm. because somebody had to take care of them. And we felt like, well, we should, because we want them to feel seen. We mm-hmm. want these people, no matter when they came in their pregnancy, to have good care.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and if they got good care, then our job is done. That's really all that matters.
Mm-hmm. So again, we just wanted to take an opportunity to highlight this very timely topic, as well as to also highlight the extraordinary documentary on Hulu, Aftershock. And if you haven't seen it, we encourage you to watch it, very mindfully, very thoughtfully, and perhaps, you know, see what ways that you can advocate for yourself or for a loved one, knowing the information that is presented. And again, we want to present information, but we want to always leave you with the sense of hope. That's why we do what we do. If we didn't think that things could change and get better, then I wouldn't be a member of this very same healthcare system. As a gynecologist now, but also still as an advocate for women's health, which includes their reproductive justice, their maternity, and gynecological issues. And so please continue to listen to us, share this episode, share all episodes of our previous two seasons. You can find us anywhere that you get your podcast episodes. And also check us out on our website at ptcobgyn.com. We look forward to seeing you soon in more episodes down the line, and we're going to sign off. But I'm going to ask Dr. Green, before she signs off, to read that last statement one more time. Again, I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I'm Dr. Karen Green. Affirming a person's dignity and making them seen is the way that you make them safe. It's not a luxury.
Take good care.